At a conference I attended recently, there was a data here from the group, Gilbane Group, which is, again, IT consultants. Multilingual communication is a business imperative. Why organizations need to optimize the global content value chain. Well, what is that? That's a real fancy way of saying it's really important to communicate to a global audience in locale-specific terms whenever possible. There's good data here, again, sort of driving at the powers that be as far as what language uptake is, some of the different audiences by regions, expectations around language, and then as well getting into some more basic ROI models and things along those lines. So I found their data extremely helpful. The next slide also, which is a good place to start, came from their presentation and talk at that conference as well. Try and tie the different components of your organization to sort of these big four corporate overarching goals that everybody has. I mean, if you're on this call, there's a good chance that you're seeking international revenues and international expansion as a way to grow your business. So within that, all of the things on the left-hand side of this slide are things that the global organization company aspires to. So again, look at the different, like, how you assess your locales and then the strategy components for reaching them. Apply them to these broader corporate goals and look to map them to your own internal efforts on the right. So, again, these are all kind of reciprocal to one another. And then, again, you know, here's, again, every organization, just so that the folks on the phone, you know, you're not alone out there. Every group, you need an executive sponsor, if you will, the visionary, someone that's willing to allocate the budget to addressing both the internationalization and the localization concerns, and then in broader terms, globalization. Don't think just as a company that's based in your country of origin or where your corporate headquarters resides. You know, think globally at all times. But now within that, you know, you have different forces, both in terms of control of the content and in terms of the budget. This executive sponsor, that visionary, has an operational champion who's overlooking the effort internationally on a day-to-day basis. But then everybody above this the graphical representation is in the push and pull in order to get this message out to a global audience. So, again, you know, those people struggle to balance both not just time and resources, but, you know, within resources, there's always people, and, yeah, there's always the cash outlay, if you will. But, again, look, in part of team building, as I spoke about earlier, look to mitigate that early on by bringing all of representatives from all of these different stakeholder groups into the same headspace. You know, don't hesitate to have an hour call, bring everybody together for a couple of days if you need to, get a game plan around all of the different interests that are involved and keep everybody in the loop accordingly going forward.
So. Okay. I'm going to sprint through these next few slides because I want to make sure we have time for Q&A. So if need be, we can come back to them. But in any case, getting specific to your organization, you know, looking again at, you know, what are the existing globalization partners, the sales force, the customer requests, new sales, and really the focus is when you're going for approval or when you're going for budget, in my mind, how can revenue and gross margins be impacted by globalization? And I actually wrote my latest article for Multilingual Computing about this. It'll probably be out next month, but if you gross margin is what's left over after the cost of sales, and that's what makes everybody happy is gross margin. So that's just a real important number, especially in current financial with what's going on in the world right now. When you're presenting ROI, there's sort of a tactical approach. The tactical approach says, well, what am I going to do right now? What's my projected 12-month revenue minus my costs, which would be like your internationalization and localization, minus your expected loss? Expected loss is sort of like a fudge number for stuff that goes wrong. Now, more strategic approach, and this is, again, if you can talk to your CFO like this and he likes it or she likes it, you will be among the higher groups of requestees. But if you look at things from a strategic perspective of what's your annual revenue and then factor in what's your growth over X years. And then, you know, if you talk about the effect on equity, Basically, you know, that's the kind of thing. If you're a global company, you've now spread out your risk of sales and downturn across globally. That has a positive effect on the value, the very value of what your company is worth. Then, of course, you get your cost to develop, just like you had up here, and your cost to maintain. That's a little different than over here because you're assuming you're maintaining it over the years. You know, again, expected losses, a little fudge factor. And then a CFO, this is sort of out of many of our scope, but a CFO might look at the opportunity of cost of funding your project versus somebody else's project. There's a white paper on that also on lingoport.com if you're interested. Now, when it comes to managing stuff, right away, if you have a new internationalization project, it's probably a good guess that you're not going to sit on your hands, have your developers sit on their hands for new software development. So you've got to think in terms of branching the code. The reason is that as you work with internationalization, you're often going to fundamentally break functionality that other people will need to be able to unit test their changes to the app. So you've got to arrange either, you know, some concurrent development freedom, as well as maybe some scheduling some code merges, either you know throughout strategic parts of the respective project plans. One of the things we do is that it's very easy with internationalization to get kind of lost as distractions pull things aside. So if you came to Lingoport on a Monday morning, you'd see that there's a very detailed meeting every morning where everybody has their milestones. There's a review of what got correctly done last week as well as what got done in the week coming. And everybody has their name on that. And the reason is that everybody has to rely on everybody. So that helps people manage their distractions. If they know they have to produce this by the end of the week, it's just human nature. The developers are going to get called into some emergency du jour. They do have to know that they are, you know, they have their stuff they still have to get done, emergency or no. One of the things that we really push for is isolating strings early. I can't tell you how many projects get stuck before we get there because nobody could quite kind of find all the strings. You know, it's the third globalized release, and there's still all kinds of English strings poking up. We advocate Globalizer. It does a really good job of finding strings. It helps you review and approve those strings, and then you can batch externalize them as well. So instead of externalizing, you know, one at a time, you can be externalizing, say, a thousand at a time. And it does all that bookkeeping for you with the string IDs and the like. And then send them off for localization early so you're ready during your testing phase to both test internationalization and then test localization. One of the things we talk about in internationalization is round-tripping of internationalized content. So an example of that, and this is where WebUX broke when I was mentioning, is, for instance, we'll take Globalizer and point this utility in Globalizer we call pseudo-judo, and we point it at the code, at the resource files, and it goes and creates a pseudo-locale. So where this might have been the original string, username and the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, we are now stretching it out, adding accents. There's a couple of Chinese characters added on the outsides of the string. The point is if it's going to break and we're going to get those square boxes, we're going to see it. We're going to see whether the string expands with the interface properly because many languages need that. So the other thing that we're big on is establishing a bug tracking database that involves not only the programmers and managers, but the translators as well. Lingoport often, for a lot of our customers, we end up hosting it for people. We use Bugzilla. It's free. It works. You might have your own bug tracking database, but I'd actually invite you to get the actual localization partner logging bugs into a common bug database, because a lot of times they are they may reflect internationalization issues. It keeps a more complete global perspective on your development.